kind of the epigraph of my talk is on my t-shirt. It's a Russian proverb which says that after you have solved the problem, you should carefully read the solution, the statement. That's what it will be about. So that's the title. That's the plan. And let's start. So I will be talking about the geometric representation theory and the archetypical example and sort of a foundational paper. It's Nakajima's papers in the 90s. So now it's part of the books, in particular his lectures. So I recall you that in the end of 70s and beginning of 90s, after the work of many people, including Vitia, Greenfield, Hitch, and Manion, Donaldson, and Nakajima, the physical problem of classification of instantons was reformulated algebra geometrically, in particular the moduli space of frame UR instanton, UR is a unitary group of charge M on the one-point compactified R4. It was reformulated as a problem of describing the moduli space of torsion theorem R shift on CP2 with the second Chern class equal to N, together with a fixed realization on the given projective line. So, and in turn, this can be restated. This moduli space can be described as certain Nakajima quiver variety. Now, much later, the conjecture, it's AGT conjecture after Aldai, Kyoto, and Tachikawa. This conjecture says that if you take the direct sum of equivariant cohomology of this moduli space, it is acted by the W algebra of the V algebra GLR. And for R equal 1, it's a result of Nakajima. I think it's still in his book or one of his papers from 90s. And so it's sort of a generalization of Nakajima. On the other hand, it's part of kind of a more general vision in physics. It's incarnation of the identity 6 equal 2 plus 4. And in particular, it's part of the Nekrasov's series of papers and the general philosophy about BPS-CFT correspondence, which predicts that various structure of four-dimensional wedge theories correspond in a trivial way to certain structures of two-dimensional conformal field theories. In particular, this W algebra comes from two dimensions and instantons come from four dimensions. So there are different ways to think about this 6 equal 4 plus 2. Another point of view which is also relevant to my talk was suggested by Gaiota. And my talk will consist of two parts. First will be kind of more rigorous, and the second will be more speculative. So in the first part of the talk, I will discuss a generalization of AGT conjecture, which is now a theorem, after the work of Malik, Akunkov, and Shiffman, and Wessirov. And this generalization reflects some kind of a three-dimensional Kaladyawa point of view on the topic. And it's related to the work of physicists. I mentioned just a few, Nekrasov, Gaiota, and Rabchak. Rabchak is a kind of a young physicist, student of Gaiota. And mathematical papers, two my joint papers, with Rabchak, Yang, Zhao. This is one paper, and the second one with Krivitsik, Chorn, and Yakonescu. The main algebraic structure which appears in this first part of the talk is cohomological whole algebra, the structure introduced 10 years ago in my joint paper with Maxim. And in the second part of my talk, I plan to speak about the subject which I am not an expert. It's three-dimensional n-equal core gauge theories, and in particular Coulomb branches, very popular topic in a geometric representation theory now. And I will try to speculate about the relationship of this with cohomological whole algebras, at least in some simple examples, as well as with my other project joined with Maxim on holomorphic Fourier theory and generalized Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. So that's a plan. Let's see how we will go. So I start with a reminder on cohomological whole algebra. In the generality, which is it's a little bit even more general than I need for today's talk. So I start with a quiver, which is endowed with a potential. This pair defines a three-dimensional collabial category. And so with this pair, one can associate an associative algebra as a graded vector space. It is given by equivariant Borel-Moore homology of the space of representations of the quiver with coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles of the potential. So potential is a cyclical invariant polynomial in arrows, so its trace is well defined, and for each dimension vector gamma, collection of non-negative integers, we can consider a representation space of the quiver, just an affine space, linear maps for associated to the arrows. And on this linear space, we have a regular function, trace of the potential. So then we can consider cohomology with coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles. And everything is invariant with respect to the gauge group, which is a product of general linear groups over the vertices of the quiver. And this gauge group acts by changing the basis. So this is a graded vector space, and the product is defined in the standard way in the whole algebra business. One consider short exact sequences and take the stack, if you'd like, of short exact sequences as a structure. The only thing which one should take care about is this sheaf of vanishing cycles, how it behaves when we say multiply spaces on which the functions are defined. And this can be done by using the Thomson-Bastiani theory, which tells how this sheaf of vanishing cycle behaves. So in any case, this graded vector space, it's graded by the dimension lattice of the quiver. This graded vector space carries a structure of an associative algebra, and this associative algebra is called cohomological whole algebra. So this is a general story, and this is what we did 10 years ago. As for today, there will be two main quivers, this A and B, both endowed with potential. The first quiver is very simple, it's just one vertex endowed with three loops, and with the potential which is W3. Unfortunately, I think this thing doesn't work, so I cannot point it out, but so I will say it in words. It's W3, which is up to cyclic permutations, so B1, B2, B3 are loops. And the potential is cubic. B3 product with a commutator of B1 and B2. There is a typo here. Commutator B1 and B3, but B1 and B2 is the all right. When you look for critical values of this potential in the representation space, it will be just a triple of commuting matrices. Oh, it works.
Which one?
No, right. Okay, great. Perfect. Triples of commuting matrices. And therefore, if you look for the representation, it will be just torsion shifts on C2. All right, so then basically this pair represents the simplest possible Calabi-Yau, which is three-dimensional vector space. Now, more interesting and sort of new for the story is this framed framed quiver Q3. So you see, if we remove these square boxes and these pairs of arrows, we get this B1, B2, B3, the quiver with the potential which I described. Now, framing consists of adding three vertices and three pairs of opposite arrows. So the numbers inside, for example, this N represents CN. It's a vector space which is placed in this vertex. And same for R1, R2, R3. These are three non-negative integers. And we place vector spaces of these dimensions in these three squares. If we remove this R1 and R2 and also these pairs of arrows, and also if we remove V3, we remove this part of the picture, what we get is a Nakajima quiver from his book, and this Nakajima quiver described the moduli space of rank R instantons, which I mentioned before. Now, although this framed quiver can be endowed with a framed potential, which is written here, it's also cubic. And it is obtained by perturbation of the whole potential W3 by the sum of three cubic terms which correspond to these three framing vertices. So, and again, everything is designed in such a way. For example, let's look at the first summum in this sum of three. Let's assume that the rest is equal to zero. If you take the critical points of the trace of this potential with respect to B3, you will arrive exactly to the Nakajima quiver relation, the commutator of B1, B2, plus sum of, plus the product of these two vertices is equal to zero. So then this is a clear generalization of Nakajima quiver and relations, but now it's a three-dimensional, it's a three Calabi-Yau square. So, and this is a point, this is important. Now, for this framed quiver, we call the representation stable, and representation should take care about the relations. It belongs to the critical locus of the trace of the potential. So it is stable when, let me go back, when there is no subspace in CN which contains the images of vector spaces coming from three framing vertices and which is invariant with respect to three loops. So this is what's written in words. There is no non-trivial V in CN, which is invariant with respect to three loops, and which contains images of vector spaces sitting in the framing vertices. So this gives a this kills the automorphism groups, and so we have the moduli space. It's a complex moduli space. Differently from the Nakajima story, it's no longer hyperkeller. So the observation is that this moduli space is isomorphic to what Nekrasov calls the moduli space of spiked instantons, which introduced in his paper. I'm not sure that the reference is readable. Yeah, 1608.007272. I think it's his second paper on this BPS CFT. And in the next paragraph, I just say that the Nakajima's story, this MRN, moduli space of torsion-free rank R, second Chern class N, shifts on CP2 with a framing. It's a special case when there is only one framing vertex is present. But differently from the Nakajima story, I don't know the pure geometric description of this moduli space. It should be the moduli space of certain coherent shifts on CQ, which are supported on the union of three coordinate planes, C square, such that on each coordinate plane they become vector bundles, torsion-free shifts of the fixed rank, and which satisfies some additional stability condition. And so we don't know how to formulate this stability condition in pure geometric way. So the moduli space from the 90s of Nakajima and others, this MRN, should be thought as the moduli space associated with geometry given by just one reduced divisor C square and C cube. All right, now having this moduli space, we define the direct sum of equivariant cohomology with coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles. This will be the module on which different algebras will act. So this vector space depends on three framings, and the sum is taken similarly to the classical story over all charges of instantons or different ends. And the equivariance is taken not only with respect to the groups which are naturally present in the story, but also with respect to the two-dimensional torus, C star square. It acts on arrows of the framed quiver by rescaling them in such a way that the Calabi-Yau condition is satisfied. So if we take, we think of the torus T2 as a subtorus in the three-dimensional torus with coordinates T1, T2, and T3, and the condition over the product of 3 is equal to 1, so then the Calabi-Yau form on C cube is preserved. So now the observation is that the various versions of this cohomological whole algebra for the quiver Q3 with a potential W3, just one vertex and three loops, three commuting loops. So this cohomological whole algebra acts on this vector space by correspondences.
What is Galois direction
vector? Now dimension vector is just a negative integer.
But it's only one.
It's zero.
The frame is three.
What is it? It's sum only over n.
Gamma is n?
Gamma is n. Okay. In the previous notation, gamma is just n. And it's exactly, if you take R1 and R2 equal to 0 and remove everything except of R3, you arrive just to this KGT story, to the moduli space which was considered by Nakajima, Malikov, and Koff. and Schiffman and Westserov. Now, so what's the point? That we can consider not only a cohomological whole algebra, but its equivariant spherical version. Spherical means exactly this. It's a sub-algebra generated just by the component corresponding to one-dimensional representation. And equivariant means that we take into account this equivariancy condition. So we add the action of the torus on the loops. All right, so then the theorem, again, it's a statement of geometric representation theory, is that the equivariant spherical cohomological whole algebra, which you can think of cohomological algebra of a stack of torsion sheaves on C cube, or a subalgebra. It acts by correspondences on this vector space. Furthermore, this algebra carries a structure of Hopf algebra, which is not true for cohomological algebra in general. But it's true for this subalgebra. And if you have a Hopf algebra structure, you can pure formally take so-called Greenfield double, which roughly speaking means that we have just positive part of some quantum group, and the Greenfield double adds negative part. And this double also acts on this direct sum of equivariant cohomology.
I see the subalgebra generated by something, yeah?
Yeah.
And it says, do you use it as a definition? Because this is a definition, it's hard to do because you don't have a control of the relations between the subsequent.
No, we do. So,
yeah,
it can be described. Actually, on the next slide, I will tell you what is it. So, first is sort of a pure geometric result similar to Nakajima. So, Nakajima defined the action of infinite Heisenberg algebra by looking at some correspondence. That's it. And the fact that these correspondences satisfy the infinite Heisenberg relation, it's kind of the result of computation. Now, comments. First, the Greenfield double of this equivariant spherical cohomological whole algebra is in fact isomorphic to some particular quantum group, which is known, can be described in terms of geometric of generators and relations. It's a fine Youngian of the Lie algebra GL1. And the fact that we can identify this spherical cohomological whole algebra with some quantum groups are sort of a collabial two-dimensional objects because they are defined by Cartan matrices, which arise in two-dimensional collabial framework. And so we have something three-dimensional, and the fact that we can go from three to two, it's a result of the dimensional reduction theorem, which we proved with Maxim in the paper on Koha 10 years ago. And basically, it's part of the possibility to make a dimensional reduction along one of the three loops. We have like three loops, B1, B2, B3, which we can informally think about three coordinates in C cube. And so we have a dimensional reduction along third dimension, so we sink to something two-dimensional. And if you kind of look carefully, after all, it's part of our paper with Rabchak, Yang, and Zhao, you see the affine Youngian of GL1. All right, it explains how you can compute something. In particular, it's part B. As a corollary, we can construct the action of some new vertex algebra introduced by physicists, by Gayota and Rabchak. It's a generalization of W algebra for GLR to three indices, R1, R2, and R3. And so they called it vertex algebra at the corner. It appears when you study boundary conditions for n equal 4 super young Milks. So this vertex algebra at the corner, it also acts on this direct sum of equivariant homology. This is another result from the representation theory, if you'd like. From physics perspective, everything is sort of almost obvious, because you have torsion shifts on C cube. This is what corresponds to the quiver one vertex three loops, and these are zero grains on this collabial threefold C cube. And you have also bound states D0 and D4. You have torsion shifts which sits on the particular divisor. Or in my case, it's a union of three divisors, three coordinate planes with different multiplicities. And you take just a BPS space, which is a direct sum of invariant cohomology. And on this BPS space, you have the action of BPS algebra of the zero grains. This is sort of a general way. You have something on the bulk, you have something on the boundary, and the algebra on the bulk acts on something associated with the boundary. There are other interpretations, but let me not to speak about them. And there are possible generalizations. This is the simplest possible Calabi-Yau, which is just C cube. If you think in terms of the topological vertex, you can glue, using just this C cube, you can glue more complicated toric Calabi-Yaus. And so we have conjectures how this result can be generalized to an arbitrary Calabi-Yau given by the toric diagram, which face is decorated by a negative rotation. All right. Now, the last slide for the first part of my talk is sort of a more geometric perspective. You see, the previous one was about quivers. And this means that I generalized this isomorphism of the moduli space of torsion-free shifts. With quiver varieties, I used just the quiver variety side and generalized it. We can try to generalize the geometric side. And instead of, as I said, considering just one coordinate plane, C square and C cube, we can consider the Hilbert scheme of points on the non-reduced divisor given by just one equation, so it's three coordinate planes with different multiplicities. So then, jointly with Chuang, Krivitsik, and Giaconescu, we proved in the simplest possible case when we have just a fat divisor, just one coordinate plane, but with a non-zero, with a multiplicity bigger than one. We proved that on the direct sum of equivariant cohomology of this Hilbert scheme, there is an action of the W algebra GLR. So this gives a different class of representations from those which I considered on the previous slides. In particular, here we get the vacuum representation. The W algebra, if you consider pure geometric setup. So we don't know how to generalize it to the general case when we have three coordinate planes. Even here, even if you take one coordinate plane with big multiplicity, the Hilbert scheme is very complicated, so very little is known about its geometry. So then we used several tricks to prove the result. In particular, we interpreted this Hilbert scheme in terms of the moduli space of Higgs bundles on the surface on CP2, endowed with a nilpotent Higgs field, which corresponds to the multiplication by the third variable, which is in this case is nilpotent. So you have x3 in the power r3 equal to 0, and x3 multiplication by x3, it's a Higgs field. And so then we use some result of Richard Thomas to study this modular space of Higgs bundles. All right, so this is the end of my first part. Any questions?
So I have some questions. In the case where you have union of three hyperplanes, and then you're looking at the crystal of endpoints on this, if you want to correspond this to a modular aspect of torsion shifts on C3, then this very torsion shift could be destabilized by its restriction to each one of these hyperplanes.
Yes, but there should be some additional stability condition, but when we speak about the Hilbert scheme, this is automatically taken into account. There are no automatic. The problem is that this is some kind of completely, not completely, but very wild Hilbert scheme, because the divisor is singular and it's not reduced. So, I mean, very, very complicated geometrically. You can still describe some stable points of the torus section, and this is how you proceed. All right, more questions? Okay, so now let's go to the second part, which is not that much related to the first one, except of the this cohomological algebra. But the second will be about this 3D n equal 4 gauge theories, and I should say very few words about the subject, so sort of a historical introduction. There are many nice papers, some I will mention some of them, but basically the history, it goes back to the 90s, actually, to the time when the mirror symmetry was discovered by physicists, but before they appreciated categorical reformulation. So in so homological mirror symmetry, it is related to compactification of strings, to be type of a string theory on mirror dual collider of three folds. So then for the corresponding quantum field theories, moduli space of vector and hypermultiplets are exchanged. So now in 96, Entrelegator and Zeiberg suggested to further compactify the story. So instead of R4, they proposed to consider 4D theories on R3 cross a circle of a given radius, and then further compactified these 4D theories, which already come from compactification of mirror dual collider, compactified by the circle. And so the point is that if we take compactifications of two mirror dual collider and take circles of opposite radius, then we get indistinguishable three-dimensional theories with n equal four theories in which moduli space of vacuo contains two components, Coulomb and Higgs branches, which are interchanged. So this is what they call mirror symmetry. So both Coulomb and Higgs branches, they are hyperkeller in some, well, in order to make this more precise, one should say many words which subsequently in this time we have been said, some, at least some of them. But anyway, the point was that we have something which is called 3D n equal 4 theories, T and T check, and when they are mirror dual, no matter what this means, that a moduli space of Coulomb and Higgs branches, some hyperkeller manifolds, they are interchanged, And this is called the mirror symmetry. So for this Coulombian Higgs branch, well, the Higgs branch is easy. Mm. The reason is that when we compactify, then the Higgs branch doesn't change. So we can, it doesn't change, and typically it is described as a quiver variety. For quiver gauge theories, it's described as a quiver variety. But the Coulomb branch, it's very much similar to homological mirror symmetry. It receives instanton corrections. And later physicists defined NP twists, like topological twists on these 3D and equal 4 theories, which gives rise to topological TFTs in dimension 3 of A and B types. All right, and this is the subject which should be studied. In this story, there is no something like SYZ conjecture. It's not immediately related to the subject which many people in this room are familiar with, but maybe is related to the subject which some other people in this room are familiar with. All right, so anyway, just to finish this. Actually, almost everything which I know about this, I learned from Tudor Demoftes, so I can recommend one of his large papers on the topic. So he argues jointly with collaborators that there are three levels of mirror symmetries in 3D and equal 4. There is a two category level, one category level, and the algebra level. At the level of two categories, one speaks about boundary conditions. At the level of one category, one speaks about symmetric monoidal category of line operators. And down to earth, so zero level, it's a shifted Poisson algebra of local operators in the bulk. And this is what will be related to the homological whole algebra, at least in examples. Now, the Coulomb branch of the theory and the physics level, it's an affine Poisson variety with an open symplectic leaf. Mathematically, most studied, it's a case when it is symplectic columns. Now, the Coulomb branch is an affine variety, and it is defined by the spectrum of a commutative algebra, which in these terms, in terms of this structure, just endomorphisms of the unit object of the monoidal category of line operators.
It's shifted.
It's minus two shifted in three dimensions, and kind of a suggestive analogy for this for the audience of kind of symplectic geometers. If you look for go down to two dimensions and n equal to two, like massive theory, Landau-Ginzburg models, then we do not have two categories. We have one category of boundary conditions, and this is an example. It's a Foucault-Azaïga category, and the algebra is just a Hochschild homology in this category, so it's minus one shift. This shift, this minus two shift, corresponds to the action of the C star. In mathematical terms, action of C star, which rescales with weight 2 the symplectic form. Okay. So anyway, so I kind of, it's a quasi-physics introduction. If you kind of do not like that, you can read papers by Braverman, Finkelberg, and Nakajima. And so then you get and some other people like Webster with collaborators, which I mentioned very soon. Anyway, so we have this singular Poisson variety, except I would say singular symplectic manifold, because it has this big symplectic leaf. So then you can expect that it can be quantized. And physicists indeed speak about quantization. They say that they turn on the omega background. I will say later how it's incorporated mathematically in this BFM story. But in any case, you get the quantized algebra. So quantized Coulomb branch. Quantized algebra, we find Poisson manifold with CM with superscript H bar. And you can again ask about reasonable category of modules over it. So if it has symplectic conic singularity, this is not the most general case from the physics point of view, but some mathematicians think that this is the only case in which everything should be formulated. Then you can take the equivariant symplectic resolution with MC hat, and now you have a smooth symplectic manifold. So you get, again, conjecturally you get the algebra of functions, and you can study the category of modules of your choice. An example, mathematical example, and it appears in physics, but kind of we can say that what's going on in mathematics. So the Coulomb branch is an important column of Lie algebra of semi-simple SLN, for example. Then, of course, MC hat is a Springer resolution of the Nilpotent column, and the quantization gives the D modules of the flag variety. So mathematically one can proceed, and this is what was done by Webster with collaborators. It's a subject of, it's called symplectic duality. You can define an abelian sort of analog of the category O of Bernstein, Dilfand, and Dilfand for an arbitrary symplectic resolution with some additional properties. And so then, in these terms, the incarnation of mirror symmetry will be kind of a causal duality of this category of O for symplectically dual complex symplectic manifolds. Mathematically, the most advanced definition of this Coulomb branch, which is a difficult part of the story. I call it that Higgs branch is always a symplectic reduction, because it's like, if you have a quiver gauge theory, it's a quiver variety, and that's... Now, Coulomb branch is difficult to define, at least it was, actually it's still kind of, you should dig into this several of papers of Braverman, Finkelberg, and Nakajima. They did not give the most general definition, but they give a definition which correspond to 3D n equal 4 theories which are parameterized by pairs, complex reductive group and its symplectic representation. For example, you can take a representation of a reductive group and take a direct sum with a conjugate, and then you get M. You get cotangent bundle to this function. All right, now their definition is sort of a very direct. You define some variety which is infinite dimensional, R, and it's very closely related to the affine Grassmannian of your group, and take the equivariant Borel-Moore homology. So then this equivariant Borel-Moore homology carries the commutative algebra structure, and you take just the spectrum of this commutative algebra, and this is a Coulomb branch. That's the definition. In the paper by Demofte and others, they present some very convincing physics argument that the physical definition as a homomorphism from the monoidal unit to itself, it agrees with the definition with the definition of BFM. Sasha is laughing, she does not agree. It's not
no, the same physical definition as a homomorphism.
Ah, yes. Yeah. All right. Yeah, but you know, physicists speak about the categories of A and B brains, about derived.
No, I know very much. Sounds great.
Yeah, okay. Anyway, and to introduce a representation theory at the quasi-classical level, physicists say that if they, you have a boundary condition, this B, bold phase B, then for categorical reasons, you have a vector space, VB, home from the monoidal unit to this boundary condition, you just look at the line operator which ends on the particular boundary. Very geometric picture. And it gives a coherent sheaf in the infrared limit with a support which is a complex Lagrangian subvariety. Now the quantization in BFN story, you just incorporate, you see instead not only this group GO acted, which appears in this affine Grassmannian story and related varieties all the time, but also the loop rotation, C star. And so the same Borel-Moore homology, equivariant Borel-Moore homology with respect to this new group, it now becomes non-commutative. And so then again, if you have like symplectic resolution, we can speak about holonomic DQ modules, deformation quantization. That's what I was about to say. Yeah, deformation quantization, and now kind of to please symplectic geometers here, since we are in the holomorphic situation and we have holonomic DQ modules, we can apply the proposal which you made with Maxim about generalized Riemann-Hilbert correspondence. So, which means that these holonomic DQ modules are converted into objects of the Foucault category of this symplectic resolution, of the symplectically resolved Coulomb branch. So this is a symplectic manifold, but now when we are on the Foucault side, we should think as a C infinity manifold with a B field. And this symplectic structure is omega, B field is B, and these are real and imaginary part of the holomorphic symplectic structure which we have. Now, the question is how to describe these objects of the Foucault category. In some simplest cases, it's possible to do. For example, for this nilpotent cone and the Springer resolution. So what we have is just a union of conormals to the Schubert cells. So it's sort of a very simple thing. More generally, again, in this story of Webster with collaborators, they define kind of a complex Lagrangian skeleton. They have not only kind of, somehow it resembles the story in symplectic geometry. There is an action of Liouville, analog of Liouville action. This is a C-star action which rescales the holomorphic symplectic form. And there is a Hamiltonian action. And this Hamiltonian action is used to define complex Lagrangian skeleton in their story, which sort of opposite to what's going on in symplectic topology. So anyway, they define this complex Lagrangian skeleton and consider deformation quantization modules which are supported quasi-classically on this skeleton. Now, the relation to cohomological whole algebra can be seen in a particular example. So we consider the 3D n equal 4 gauge theory, what they call of Jordan type. It corresponds to the reductive group JLN and its symplectic representation, which is a direct sum of its representation n and the dual one. And the representation n is given by the direct sum of copies of the natural vector representation and the adjoint representation in JLN. Well, the corresponding quantum Coulomb branch was computed very explicitly in the paper by Kadera and Nakajima, and it's what they found, that it's also some known quantum group which is called shifted Youngian, and this shifted Youngian it's related to cohomological whole algebra at least in two different ways. One is sort of conjectural. One should take the three-dimensional Calabi-Yau, which is a product of the cotangent bundle to P1 with the line, and take cohomological whole algebra of this. And double of it is isomorphic to the shifted affine Youngian. But there is kind of a more direct approach. So we made some computations which show that there is a cohomological whole algebra of the affine of the type which I consider in the first part of my talk, with a homomorphism to this shifted affine Youngian. Now just a few minutes left. So this is just another class of examples which are more closely related to the slices in affine Grassmannian. This is also part of BFN story, but let me skip it and go to the geometry for the remaining maybe 5 minutes. So this is just kind of a summary of the algebraic part. And the thing is that kind of what we expect, that there is a homomorphism of a double of equivariant spherical cohomological whole algebra to the quantized Coulomb branch, at least for any quiver 3D n equal 4 quiver gauge theory. So that's expectation.
So here you are seeing arbitrary.
Here, yes, arbitrary, yes. But so far we have made computations only for simplest cases. All right. Now, now the story, the last part of the talk is sort of a speculation about why cohomological whole algebras should appear at all. And this is more of geometric argument, which is not about quivers with a potential, but it's based on actually two different type of, there are two different type of motivations. One, which we considered with Maxim 10 years ago, it's kind of to construct cohomological whole algebra for the, say, compact Calabi-Yau threefold, and end of it with a potential which is a holomorphic Chern-Simons. It's written here. So it's an obvious generalization of the usual Chern-Simons. Critical locus of this holomorphic Chern-Simons are just holomorphic vector bundles. So then you can imagine the derived category of coherent sheaves on this Calabi-Yau threefold X. It should be taken this category. We should, this is the potential for this Calabi-Yau category, and we should take the direct sum of Borel-Moore homology of this stack, actually, more precisely, we should consider kind of an infinity stack, but again, everything is not too conjectural. Let's take just a stack of coherent sheaves, end of it with a potential, which is a holomorphic Chern-Simons, pretend that we can define Borel-Moore homology of this stack with coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles. And this is cohomological whole algebra. You can do it for complexified Chern-Simons on the real three-dimensional compact manifold, which is easy. Critical points are just flat connections. Now, 5 years ago, Nakajima proposed to define the Coulomb branch using the Borel-Moore homology with coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles with a sort of a holomorphic Chern-Simons functional. And then to use the ideas of Mativic-Donaldson-Thomas theory, which we developed with Maxim in these two papers, and in the geometric framework related to three-dimensional Calabi-Yaus, it's a work of Joyce and Song. So, and here is his precise proposal. So I follow to Nakajima. And we consider theories which, again, correspond to pairs, the reductive group and its symplectic representation, G and M. His proposal is more general than is needed. So if we start with an arbitrary Riemann surface C, then we can define this Chern-Simons version of Nakajima, which is a function on fields which are pairs of 0-1 connection, as same as for holomorphic Chern-Simons, and the Higgs field. And this symplectic representation phi, it's incorporated in the definition of the Higgs field. So the definition of the Chern-Simons Nakajima functional is this integral. So where we use the natural pairing. So this also people who know Zeidberg-Wittgenstein's story from 90s, they will see something reminiscent to that. Anyway, this is the functional, and so we can look for critical points, and these are critical points. They are described quite explicitly, sort of a Zeidberg-Wittgenstein type equation, and they involve the moment map of the symplectic reduction this symplectic vector space with respect to the action of the group. Now, the proposal of Nakajima is that if you take as a curve the Riemann surface P1, then we get the algebra of functions the Coulomb branch if we consider the equivariant homology of the space of solutions to this equation with the coefficients in the sheaf of vanishing cycles. Rather, we take compactly supported cohomology, take dual, which is Borel-Moore homology, and this is algebra of functions on the Coulomb branch. So this is, of course, definition very much similar to the definition of homological whole algebra. Okay, and finally, few comments. Let's skip the first one, which is just a derived interpretation of the story, and just last two. The definition, if we look for the definition of the Coulomb branch proposed by Braverman, Finkelberg, and Nakajima, obviously they are related to the geometry of singular monopoles in three dimensions. This is a geometry of an affine three-dimensional manifold, which is endowed with an affine one-dimensional foliation and transversal complex structure. So the space which they considered the main space R, it is obtained by the gluing of two formal disks together everywhere except of the centers. If you just think a little bit in terms of complex geometry, just pair of complex curves which collide everywhere except of one point, which is a singularity. And so you can think that you have some real three-dimensional picture with one-dimensional foliation, and this formal disk is just a transversal structure. And this geometry appeared, in particular in my last talk here, and in my work with Maxim on parabolic Foucault categories for surfaces. And also, of course, it can be related on the DQ module side with all the idea of Maxim of elliptic space, which goes back to the 90s, maybe even earlier than, or at the same time, maybe the mirror symmetry. Now, on the last side, I explain why this geometry, how this geometry can be relevant to this 3D n equal 4, and how three dimensions appear from compactified complex symplectic surfaces. But since I'm wrong out of time, I should stop. Okay, thank you.
So in the first part of the talk, naive question is, why did you think of union of three hyperplanes?
No, that's what I said, that it's not important, it's just the first example, already highly non-trivial, because it appeared in this Gajota and Rabchak vertex algebra at the corner. More generally, you can take toric diagram of a toric three-dimensional Calabi-Yau, you take a fat, I mean, any non-reduced toric divisor, and so the expectation is that this toric can be generalized.
Maybe just a curious question. You said that to capture these modulized pieces, you're using the result of Richard, that you have these torsion shift modulized pieces project onto the surface and you get this Higgs bundles with nilpotent Higgs field. So when you have this situation where you have three hyperplanes, then
Of course, you can take dimensional reduction to each of these, and you have three Higgs moduli spaces. But how to combine them?
Okay. My question was whether you actually did.
It's just a technical trick.
Other questions?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay.